just know enough. Life out here is mighty rough. All these things I can't control got me by the stranglehold.
Hello and welcome to our State of Affairs portion of the program, where we're very pleased to speak with Mr. Ray Kurt Johnson. Welcome to the Collegium.
Very good to be here.
Ray Kurt, could you tell us a little bit about your background, please?
Very full musical childhood and music family. My beginnings within the church, Baptist Church in Washington, D.C., and where my grandmother, yes, took us kids every Sunday, and I started singing in the choir and learning music, and I went to a military school when I was very young, and so, yeah, where they had military training, but the education was by nuns, the sisters, and so, but then it was a very, very special Sister Maria who first sat me down at a piano and taught me Mozart, and then that was the beginning, the Mozart and Beethoven, and then I was always playing piano and singing, and then when I was a teenager, then I had an interest with the violin, or the viola, as I began, and I still kept playing.
How many children, young people from your neighborhood or your environment eventually went into playing music on violin, and particularly music by composers like Mozart?
Well, in Washington, D.C., we did have a program that was for kids and for parents to take their children on the weekends, on Saturdays when they are, the D.C. Youth Orchestra. And so there were plenty of kids that went to that program, but yet that continue to this day were very few. But a lot of people had a musical influence, and I knew then I wanted to play, make music, because I was always singing, always, and I was studying the classics, and I had good teachers and that promoted good music. Tutelage.
What are you doing in Germany?
Well, I think it's my own personal graduate study. I feel like that my life has been one endless tour since I've been out of music school, which was in Rochester, New York, Eastman School of Music. And ever since I've been out of there, I've been just exploring life and music, just with that, and going with it, and playing in different venues, whether it be in a band or studio, television orchestra or chamber orchestra, in New York City, and it has taken me many places in the world, and that's only by the grace of God from what the talent has brought me, and yeah.
Well, what are your expectations for your? What do you expect from the future, and what do you expect from your time here, say in Europe?
Well, I would like to record and create the music that and the music sound that I feel that I a direction I want to go and take this with the violin, or be it singing and composing. I like chamber music. I really like that genre of music. But then also in the context not only of classic music is popular music, but then the jazz, and jazz music is a symbiosis of classic, because it's very well studied form. And so, yeah, all of these cultures and music forms, they will merge as such. But there are just many ways to do it, and that's the fun of it.
How would you compare the experiences, say, that you're having here in Europe with the experiences that you had in the United States?
Well, I feel as an artist, there's a great deal of more respect here in Europe than it is for within America, just based on the commercial aspect of it. It's all about, making money, so to speak. Whereas, yes, people make money in Europe, but the art is what's foremost and is foremost first importance. And that's where what brings me here, because I feel that that's nurtured and I can nurture, develop more in that aspect, because that's important as any musician. I mean, you can make money at anything, really, if you have to, but can you make music? And yeah.
Are you studying, and where are you living now also in Germany?
Well, right now I'm living in Leipzig, Germany, and that's a very classical historical town in that respect. And so I'm learning, studying the old forms and the theories of the, old world, and traveling a bit more in Europe and getting more of a sense of formal, the identity of that, and then how I can relate to that. But then everyone's an individual, and every artist must develop their own, in that sense. So to get a basis of where this music comes from and where, and it's also developing in itself. There's a great trend within Leipzig and modern music and the technology and mixing with trance beats and things like that. It's all a open field of creativity.
Where do you think the field of so-called European classical music and the other influences from popular music and other classical musics from various parts of the world, what sort of synthesis do you think this might produce in the future?
Well, I think right now, because everything is going towards the dependency on the technology and the computer, whereas instead of the computer necessarily taking over or everything's being used within that, how can the computer enhance what we do naturally? That's how I see it, and want to develop that. Whereas, this is a very acoustical instrument. It's very powerful. I mean, when I play this, whether in a concert hall or in a subway station, the acoustics and the sound is very big for such a tiny piece of wood. But but then within the technology and the use of recordings and everything we do, there's such a take it to another level. And then how to enhance it within live performance, because that's what's important for musicians. That's the only realm we have left, because everything else is digitalized and internet, and so you can't play live from that. Right. So how can it help, live performance in that sense?
What are the future, do you think, for the young musicians that are developing, say, in the area where you come from, which is, I believe, Washington, D.C.?
Yeah. Well, it's very difficult, because there's everything is somewhat in the works of marketing, and what instruments you have, and everything is very expensive. And but in terms of... I don't know, the old-fashioned way of teaching music does not go away. You still have to read the music. You still have to learn chords. You still have to learn scales. You still have to practice. You still have to, and no computer or, other machines cannot do that for you.
Would you advise young people to look seriously into the field of music that you're pursuing?
Yes. If not, as a profession, Yeah, I think it has a long-standing life that will be around. But just for the enjoyment, because if I didn't enjoy the music, compared to the business aspects of it, I don't think I would have hung out so long.
But Ray Kurt Johnson, thank you very much for joining us here on the Collegium, and we will hear more of your artistry after we leave the break. Thank you. Thank you.
Hello and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and our arts calendar. In addition to staying cool, remember you are participating in what else but The Collegium.
Hello, and welcome to a special presentation of The Collegium. Here at the Brot Fabriek, we're presenting the 15th Black International Cinema. And we're in the gallery where you have just seen some of the pictures, some of the photographs that are being presented as a part of the festival. The history of the Fountainhead Tanztheater, in part, from 1980 until the present. We're very pleased to be joined by a friend of ours, a lady with whom we've worked for a number of years, first in Berlin and now in Dusseldorf, Miss Christina Kronberg. Welcome to the Film Festival and the Collegium. We're going to turn the microphone over to her and she's going to tell us about what she's been doing.
Actually, I was trying to prepare a sort of a Gastspiel of the Black International Cinema in Dusseldorf, because I wanted my friends to come to Dusseldorf to show the audience in Dusseldorf what they have been doing and what great productions they have. And I thought that might be something interesting for Dusseldorf as well. And so we arranged a place where we can do all this. We are going to show 24 films in 3 days, from the 12th to 14th of May. And in addition to that, we have a program of groups, of local groups in Dusseldorf, who present themselves and give some cultural, how should you say, contribution, like dance, music, singing. And this will be a program on the 13th of May. And then Saturday night, you're going to perform with Insanity and Ain't I a Woman? Yeah, and then there will be a final discussion about the topic, dialogue between the cultures, is this possible in Germany? Yes, and we hope we get some interesting points of views to that topic. this is what we're going to prepare, or what we prepared until now.
Christina, having lived in Berlin and now living in Dusseldorf, how would you compare the two cities in relationship to the kinds of artistic, cultural, and educational activities that we're engaged in?
Shall I take this again, yeah? Well, actually, I didn't jump into that cultural scene so far in Düsseldorf. Of course, I mean, Düsseldorf is a very small city in comparison to Berlin, and there's, because of that, much less activities and much less alternative activities we have. Of course, the opera, the theaters, and all that. But, less alternative things. And the alternatives, I already know. I know that they have been there for years already, so that they are all already some kind of established, you know. You cannot speak of them like alternative anymore. So let's see if in the future there will rise up something new. I don't know.
Christina, while you were in Berlin, we worked together on a newspaper entitled The Planet, and now you're working on another publication in Dusseldorf. Maybe you could tell us about that.
Yeah, the publication we work on in Dusseldorf is called Dialogue, and accidentally, I have an exemplar here, a copy, Dialogue. And it's more or less the same idea as we had here with The Planet. It is that people can write in their own tongue in many languages, and we try to bring just different point of views and different experiences and opinions from people who just don't have access to the normal, to the usual media. And it's really well recognized, you can say. Yeah, people like it, and it's just something that was missing so far in Düsseldorf. And we do that all, as always, voluntarily, without getting paid. And the project can be done just by all the volunteer work from all the different people. Yeah.
While you were in Berlin, we worked together on the open channel, the OKB. And as you probably heard, there are some difficulties. Is there something comparable to the OKB in Dusseldorf? And what is your opinion of the situation that the OKB seems to find itself in?
I must admit that I haven't heard about difficulties on the OKB. I mean, sorry. And there is leider no possibility for Düsseldorfers to make TV, their own TV. We don't have that in Düsseldorf. We just have radio. And yeah, and I miss the TV really very much because I thought it was just a very easy way to reach people, a very easy way.
What are the, as far as you know, what are the economic possibilities for the artists there? That is, in terms of the support from the governmental organizations or the foundations there in Dusseldorf?
Well, I think it's not as bad as in Berlin.
Okay. Quick to Dusseldorf.
Yes, hurry up. No, Düsseldorf is a city of money, and it's a city of trade, and has always been quite a lot of money for cultural things. I mean, they are always in this old competition with Cologne, and they have to invest in things like that, you know. And for example, in North Rhine-Westphalia is the unique Bundesland, which has money for the so-called third world activities. And it's 50 pfennig for each inhabitant of North Rhine-Westphalia, for each community, for each city. And they give that for projects in North Rhine-Westphalia who promote activities in the so-called third world countries. And this is a single, unique in Germany. So this is something, I think, additional, extra.
I think she said extra. You were telling me a little bit about a project that you're supporting that's going to Burundi. Perhaps you could inform our viewers about that.
We're going to support a project of a musical with Straßenkindern. I don't know how to say street.
Street children.
Yeah. Street children in Burundi, and it's Inish, the founder or the one who had the idea, is a journalist of France, and he's been working in this area of Burundi, Rwanda for several years. And with all the mess of the war and the civil war there in this area, a lot of children are just without their parents. They're left without their parents. And he had the idea to do something for the children and by the means of culture, and to promote an idea of reconciliation and peace among the people of Burundi. And he's going to, he already has all more or less installed. He has the people who trained in dance and singing and music, and he has contacts to well-known musicians and dancers from that area. People who are already experienced in working with street children from other countries. And the idea is to produce this musical in direction to Sarafina. Mm-hmm. This is more or less the forebild. And he will start in this in September.
I know that you work with a number of, or a group here in Berlin. What are the activities that you're engaged in with the people here in Berlin?
You mean the humanist movement? Well, we, for example, as a more or less political activity, we have a happening here in June in Berlin. Right now we are collecting signatures in Munich, in Düsseldorf, Cologne, and Berlin. We have a more or less a common activity. How you say Kündigung? And just to fire somebody. It's called Kündigung für Kohl. Mm-hmm.
Know about that.
Yes. And the idea is to... Kohl is just a figure, it's a symbol for the stages we see the democracy is in, you know, with all this corruption and that people really traitors are traitors to the ones who vote for them, yeah?
Betray the people.
Yeah, you know, they betray the people, and the people lost a lot of faith in politics and all that, and Kohl is just a symbol for that. And we don't want such people to continue in their work in the Bundestag. You know, we want a new kind of politicians. Yeah, and so we ask people to sign the Kündigung für Kohl, and we want to hand it over to the Reichstag or the Bundestag here in Berlin. And I think maybe Angela Merkel would be a nice person to address this Kündigung to. And just, yeah, and to combine that with a sort of a demonstration, you know, just like there's a lot of people who are not agree with this kind of politics and we do want something else. Yes.
Well, in addition to organizing the film festival and doing all sorts of other things, as you can see, she's actively engaged in the politics of Germany. Well, I'm sure that they can use your insight and intelligence and certainly goodwill.
I don't want them to use mine.
Not yours.
No, I mean, I don't want them to use this, you know? I mean, we want to do something else. It's not the game of use and abuse and misuse anymore.
Right.
Okay?
Right. In that case, I think what she has in mind is that we all move forward. On that note, we want to thank you for joining us here, and we look forward to visiting with you and spending time in Düsseldorf. So stay with us, and remember, you are participating in The Collegium.
Ernestine Anderson, A Lovely Way to Spend an Evening. Ich würde gerne im Rahmen von Jazzradio dem Berliner Fountainhead Tanztheater und seinem Direktor Professor Donald Muldrow Griffith gratulieren. Denn die haben eine ganz besondere Auszeichnung erhalten, und zwar vom Bündnis für Demokratie und Toleranz für den Einsatz von Professor Griffith und seinen Kollegen zur Förderung der hervorragenden Beziehung der Gemeinschaft durch ihr TV-Programm The Collegium. Das Programm wird dreimal die Woche vom Community Channel Alex Berlin ausgestrahlt und darüber hinaus in anderen Städten Deutschlands und in den USA. Gestern wurde die Auszeichnung im Roten Rathaus verliehen. Und ich darf auch nebenbei noch erwähnen, dass Professor Donald Muldrow Griffith ein ziemlich talentierter Jazzsänger ist. Und welch schöneren Weg gibt es, zu Toleranz und Verständnis aufzurufen, als durch die Kunst, durch Musik und durch den Jazz. Also Gratulation. Und hier und jetzt geht's natürlich auch weiter mit Jazz. Soul Talk sind hier mit Loving You.
On a clear day, rise and look around you, and you'll see who you are. Clear day, how it will astound you that the glow of every star, you'll feel a part of every mountain, sea, and shore. You can hear from far and near a world you've never heard before. And on that clear day, sort of reminiscing, if you will, about a woman that I fell in love with a long time ago. Well, this was a very special woman. You know, I thought I was a pretty cool dude, smooth as it could be. But when I met this woman, well, I found out that I wasn't quite as cool as I thought I was. She was beautiful, intelligent, talented. But she was powerful. There was something very strong about this woman. But over a period of time, she decided to show me her vulnerable side, and we came together. And it was wonderful. But of course, there's a sad side to this story, too. And the sad side basically was my fault. I'll tell you about it. I was saying, I don't know, I made some mistakes and I caused us to come apart.